For decades, the large car was Australia's favourite vehicle type. Then it was small cars, as the likes of the Mazda 3 and Toyota Corolla started to outsell Commodores and Falcons. But now medium-sized SUVs are threatening to become the country's most dominant vehicle segment, with help from this quintet of notable nameplates. They comprise the Kia Sportage and Hyundai Tucson twins from South Korea, and from Japan, the Honda CR-V, Mazda CX-5, and the newest of this group, the latest generation Subaru Forester. So, with help from Kurt and Rob, we're going to find out which is the best value, best all-rounder pick of this highly popular bunch. It makes sense to start with a newbie, the Subaru Forester, that is in its fifth iteration since 1997, and while looking similar to its most immediate predecessor, has grown again in size. We're focusing on the mid-30Ks price zone, rather than base models for this comparison, so we need to pretend we have the 35,490 Forester L variant, rather than the 38,490 premium supplied for this test. For starters, you can ignore those 18-inch wheels. The L sits on 17s as standard. The L, however, is loaded with features, including many not standard on its direct rivals. These include a new infrared interior camera that can monitor your face and warn you if it thinks you're not paying attention to the road, while it will also personalise the cabin climate and instrument display when it recognises a particular driver.
Lots of screens. Lots of colourful screens.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3. Lots of information. But overall, what do you think of the design? I mean, we've got this sort of an interesting mix of material, so it's certainly not boring. There's some creative thought that's gone into designing the Forester, and that's not something you would have necessarily said about previous generations.
Yeah, certainly looks good. I wouldn't do what I'm doing at the moment and wiggle too many things either.
It's a little bit wiggle there.
How you're for room in the back there?
Yeah, heaps of room. It's on a par with the Sportage, but not quite as much as the CR-V.
We're into our fifth generation Forester now, but something that has been a constant, the very tall glass ratio.
Yeah.
So you've got fantastic vision whether you're in the front or back seat. So that's
absolutely congruent with that.
Glad that they've carried that over. But something else you would have said that was a bit of a Forester tradition would be a really quite sort of smooth, relaxing ride, and at least at low speed so far, it feels like things have firmed up a bit and not necessarily for the better. All right, let's try this engine. So a 2.5 litre boxer four-cylinder. Apparently, according to Subaru, it's had extensive changes. So upgrades to the engine, upgrades to the auto. Okay, it's launch control time, fellas. Hold on to your pants.
A lot of noise.
Yeah, but not, I wouldn't say it was truly unpleasant.
No.
You know, for a CVT, you know, respectable performance.
We didn't get a chance to test it today, but one of my bugbears about Subaru's boxer engines is that on cold startup, they love to buzz around at about 2,000 RPM, annoying you and all your neighbours while it warms up. And I don't quite know why that seems to be a trait of this particular engine, but it's something definitely to put into consideration.
Well, that was the eyesight system, which is standard on all of the Foresters, so certainly something that's noteworthy about the new Forester is it's got a heck of a lot of active safety gear in it from base model upwards,
which is great provided it doesn't just randomly go beep 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 and for no good reason. I would have thought,
how does that sound go again, Kurt? It
goes beep 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 beep.
That's very good.
That is good.
Big sun visors as well. Huge!
Oh, I can't see where we're going! The steering to me is probably my least favourite of the group.
Heavy?
It's not so much that it's heavy, it's effortless enough for getting you around. It just feels a bit weird around the straight ahead. It's not sure whether it wants to be heavy or light.
Further testing at higher speeds and in less densely populated areas confirms the Forester has lost some of its absorptive qualities of previous models, while the steering has an aloof relationship with the front wheels it turns. If you have any intention of going off the bitumen, it's worth noting the Forester has the highest ground clearance here and permanent all-wheel drive, unlike the on-demand systems common to its rivals. There's decent performance from the heavily upgraded 2.5-litre four-cylinder petrol engine, and the CVT is fairly responsive for this type of automatic transmission, which is handy as Subaru no longer offers turbo petrol or diesel alternatives. The 8-inch touchscreen display you see in this video is for higher spec models. The L makes do with a 6.5-inch screen, that's the smallest offered in this group, and it also misses out on integrated navigation. Good job Apple CarPlay and Android Auto smartphone mirroring tech is now included on the Forester for the first time. And the Forester not only gets more features than ever before, but in addition to its roomier cabin, there's also now extra cargo space. So we've got one of the widest apertures for the Forester's boot and the highest loading lip in the group, which some people might like, or they might prefer it to be a bit lower, like the CRVs. We've got a very nicely presented boot though. We've got this really nice sort of quality plastic here, feels very durable, nice carpet. Cargo blind, that's standard. We've got hooks, we've got tie down points down here. Now, a couple of things we do need to point out that aren't really supposed to be on this car. We're supposed to have a 2.5 IL. This is a premium, so we do get an auto tailgate. And we get these very fancy electric release levers. Press that, one touch, straight flat down, 60-40 split seats, lovely.
Hyundai's original Tucson and its replacement, the iX35, were nothing to write home about. Thankfully, the latest Tucson released in 2016 has since banished memories of its so-so predecessors. It was also given a refresh in mid-2018, with interior changes more obvious than the exterior styling tweaks. The model grade we have here is the Elite, but to keep pricing within the right bracket, it means front-wheel drive rather than all-wheel drive, and the least powerful engine of three available. Even then, it's the most expensive model of our group, costing from $37,850. As you would expect for the South Korean model, there's plenty of standard equipment. This includes leather-appointed upholstery, electrically adjustable driver's seat, and heated side mirrors with auto-fold, all of which are only shared with the Kia Sportage here, while the Tucson is the only other SUV to match the Forester's adaptive cruise control.
All right, we've got some colour.
Yes.
We do have some colour, hooray!
An interesting colour.
It is an interesting colour. It's tan, or as I like to call it, caramel space food stick. And we've got a rather, I don't know whether it's a fetching grey or it just looks like it's an interesting grey because it's next to an interesting space food stick colour.
Liking caramel. That's the description.
I like space food sticks.
Caramel?
It's nostalgic.
But it does give the cabin a bit of a lift.
Well, I only drove a Tucson a few months ago before this 2018 facelift, and one of my criticisms of the interior was that it was just a bit kind of bland, and it was kind of lacking colour, a bit of sophistication. This is a real transformation.
General room, how are you doing back there, Rob?
It's probably on a par with the CX-5, so that still leaves, at this point, the Kia, the backseat space champion, but the seat is the most comfortable of the ones I've sampled so far. You tend to sit a little bit more in it, and this space food stick colour does just give it a nicer ambience. It feels a lot airier in the back.
So you think there's less space than in the Kia?
I think there is, yes.
That's interesting, because the car being twins, they're on exactly the same wheelbase. So
you've also got a high window line up there as well, which is much like the Kia, difficult for little kids to see out of.
Yep. Yeah, it's a 2-litre, funny enough, it's shared with the Sportage, but the Hyundai's gets a little bit of extra power and torque. I don't know if that's the parent company kind of just putting its foot down and saying, oh, we're going to have a little bit more than little Kia. Does seem to make a slight difference. Just it feels a little bit more effortless than the Kia's engine. It's really felt that you're getting to a point where, okay, I'm going to have to really push harder on this accelerator to move this thing, where you don't get that same sense in the Tucson.
I've happened to have spent some time in this car, and I can tell you one bugbear that these A-pillars are huge. You could hide. You could hide a G wagon behind those roofs.
They are chunky.
But at least they're finished in caramel.
Very smooth steering on the Tucson as well. You know, they've really come on leaps and bounds, these South Korean brands, with the way that their cars drive. I mean, who remembers driving the original Tucson?
Yes.
No.
You know, well, if you do remember it, why do you remember it? Because it was instantly forgettable.
Give it the berries.
Okay. We'll just check he's looking where he's going. Okay, here we go.
It's fairly boisterous, but I don't think it's not quite as annoying as the Mazda.
The Tucson's 2-litre is essentially the same engine used in the Sportage SLI, also in our test, but squeezes out more power and torque, courtesy of direct fuel injection and a higher compression ratio. It makes the Hyundai slightly more responsive than the Kia, though the engine needs to be worked hard for meaningful momentum and it can sound strained. There's much more to like about the way the Tucson rides and steers. The damping is nicely judged, providing for easy-going passage along urban and suburban roads. The steering, which is satisfyingly smooth and linear, completes some of the best work done by Hyundai Australia's local engineering team.
So, as a twin to the Kia Sportage, no surprise, it's a bit of a game of spot the difference in the Tucson's boot. Very similar size, so a good size. You've got the same cargo blind that can be repositioned lower here to work as a barrier. We've got hooks, we've got exactly the same tie-down points that pull out of the sides. And again, we're missing the release levers for the seat backs, 60-40. One difference though, which a lot of families will appreciate, we get a 12-volt socket in the Tucson's boot where you don't in the Sportage.
As a twin to the Hyundai Tucson, it's perhaps no surprise the latest generation Kia Sportage debuted in the same year, 2016. And that it also adopted an update in mid-2018. Our Sportage here is also a front drive model with a 2-litre petrol engine. The SLI two-wheel drive is slightly cheaper than the equivalent Tucson at $36,790. If you want all-wheel drive, it's a scary $5,400 premium, though you do get a torquey turbo diesel engine. SLI misses out on the Tucson Elite's blind spot and rear cross traffic detection, but adds front sensors, a feature matched only by the CRV. It also comes with the longest factory warranty available, 7 years.
The first impressions are it's very dark in here. Kia likes a dark cabin, don't they?
They do, and sort of dull black plastics.
Yeah.
This belt line in the back's quite high, so if you're a little person, you're going to be hunkered down.
And so, as I said, this is my first time in the Sportage. The footrest is really high for some reason, so I'm actually struggling to get a ideal driving position, because I kind of feel that this is kind of right for me in terms of my distance to the wheel, but then I put my foot on the left and it's like, look how high my knee is.
So it's quite dark in here, a little bit premium by numbers because they've got tiny little bits of I guess satin silver and a couple of, well, only really on the steering wheel.
Yeah,
you've got piano black on the steering wheel.
The little other toggle switches, which look alright. I mean that's a little bit of a premium feel.
Yeah.
Nice leather steering wheel.
It's a pleasant design. I do like the dash. It's just colorization-wise, it's just a bit dour.
Yeah, the texturing. Yeah,
nice big clear digital speedo you've got there.
It's very nice. I do like a digital speedo. In fact, all cars should have it in Australia because of our approach to speed enforcement, shall we say, in a polite way.
So, what's the general room like back there, Rob?
It's very very spacious, but then, you know, Jez isn't the tallest person on the planet.
Oh,
so.
Easy. Jeez.
No, there's a ton of room back here.
Come on, engine, you can do it.
It's a bit workmanlike, but even from the passenger seat, I like the fact that it's a conventional auto and it doesn't slur along like a CVT might heading up the hill.
The auto is doing a good job there. I think the auto, as much as us, would just like some more torque. Right, another hill.
Bit of wheel spin.
Do you think we're in the front wheel drive version?
I'd want to hope so.
The throttle response is nice when you're just using it lightly and you just need to, you know, do that stop-start.
Yeah.
Driving around town. It's just when you want more from the engine, you start pressing harder on that accelerator, and just, yeah. Needs more oomph.
So this is the 2 litre.
Yeah, so I think...
Not the 2.4. So.
No, it's a 2 litre, and I believe it does have the lowest power and torque figures in our group.
It's 114 kilowatts and 192 newton metres.
Okay, so look, no medium SUV should have less than 200 newton metres in my book. You've got city cars that have 200 newton metres, for goodness sake.
Yeah.
You know, and you're trying to move 1.5 tonnes, and that's before you start adding people.
It's probably not the most pliant ride out there, but I wouldn't call the ride harsh at all. Decent headroom.
Lots of headroom.
Yep. You've got a funny little cutout there for the handle that they didn't give you.
As a vision is pretty good all round, actually. I have a good shape to the side mirrors, and the elongated rear door glass is good as well. So you've got good over-the-shoulder vision. Would actually be better, I say, pay attention. My revision would be better if there wasn't a camera right there. Oh, sorry, we're not meant to mention that.
You're destroying the magic of television.
Hold on, where's the fourth wall? Where is it?
The magic of you.
Oh, there it is.
To be fair, the Sportage was driven in slightly damp conditions that started drying out as we cycled through our other models. Traction is good in the dry, even if the Kia's propensity to wheel spin and torque steer in the wet makes a good case for all-wheel drive. The Kia's petrol engine is also likeable, despite its lack of torque. It's a smooth performer in conjunction with a 6-speed auto. But hills and overtaking become more of a challenge, and it's no coincidence the Sportage and its Tucson twin use the most fuel, according to official fuel consumption figures. We're certainly big fans of the Sportage's interior design, though the dark plastics and uninspiring textures lower perceived quality, even compared with the Tucson. There's an argument the Kia's integrated touchscreen looks more effective than the Hyundai's floating design, though that's subjective. What's less debatable is that the two identical systems are very good and provide the largest displays on test. The Kia and Hyundai are also the only SUVs here with branded audio systems that also sound the best. The Sportage gets a JBL system, the Tucson an Infiniti unit. Are there any differences between the boot compartments though? So no auto open close function for the tailgate. It's a good size boot. We've got a cargo blind, and that can also be moved down to this position here, so it can act as a barrier to keep your goods from sliding out. We've got pull out tie down points. We've got some little hooks there. No release levers though for the seat backs. 60-40 split fold, so you've got to go around to the side of the car, flick a lever on the side of the seats, but they do go flat. Honda's latest fifth generation SUV was released in mid-2017, so it's still relatively fresh. It became the first CR-V to offer 7 seats, which gives it a distinctive option in this group. The third row seating is available only in the 38,990 VTI-L, where here we have the VTI-S. Priced from $33,290, you can consider it the most affordable SUV here if you're content with just 2 driven wheels. Or pay an extra $2,200 to get all-wheel drive and still have the joint cheapest model next to the Forester L. It joins its Japanese compatriots in making metallic paint inclusive of the price, where the 2 South Koreans charge extra. It's quite well specified too, with 18-inch alloys, front sensors and the only automatic tailgate in the group. However, it's also the only model here to lack rain-sensing wipers, digital radio, and autonomous emergency braking.
All right, Honda.
Yes.
Hyundai.
So, cloth seats, but I have to say, altogether a little bit more premium feeling than the same cloth trim in the CX-5.
Slightly more sort of futuristic feel to the dash. I got this humongous digital display in front of me with the largest possible speedo numbers you can imagine. So you've got no excuse for not knowing what speed you're doing. This is my the best driving position I've been able to achieve.
Excellent
so far.
Visibility as well. Like the bonnet and the dash line is quite low. Reasonably thin A pillars, so. Yeah, visibility's great.
Well, this centre console's brilliant, I reckon. You've got big cup holders. There's just, you know, you've got no excuse for not finding somewhere to stick your drinks, your smartphone, some coins.
Standard armrest with a couple of square cup holders, which is good for those square coffee cups. There is a ton of room in the back here, and I know Jez isn't the tallest human, but this is by far the most spacious back row that we've sat in yet. The seats are quite comfortable too.
This is actually the only turbocharged engine we've got in the group. It's only a 1.5, but you've got 240 newton meters of torque.
Yeah, and you can feel it.
And that's between 2,000 and 5,000, so it suggests it's got some really nice flexibility there. But the downside is that it is mated to a CVT auto, and for me, performance still feels more sluggish than it should. I just think, you know, I think this is a really good engine here, and you don't quite get the best of it with the CVT. And I'd really like to drive this engine with a manual gearbox. But guess what? There's no manual gearbox.
Boo. Boo Honda, boo. Kind of lopes along. Kind of lopes a bit with its ride.
I think it's not a bad thing. No, I think there's some nice suppleness to this ride. It's perhaps not riding quite as beautifully as it was with just me on board, having a couple of fatties on. I mean, with you two on board.
It's payback, isn't it, for all the short jokes?
Like berries.
Yeah, it's a fair bit of volume there, isn't there?
A bit of volume, but can I say it feels. It has the most urgency of the ones we've driven so far.
He says from the back seat.
Yeah. he's feeling the full experience back there. Yeah.
The more we drove these SUVs, the more obvious it became that the CR-V has the most beautifully cushioned ride of this quintet, if run fairly close by the Tucson. Its interior is a bigger standout though. In a way, the CR-V turns convention on its head, because despite having the shortest distance between front and rear wheel axles, the Honda has the most spacious cabin by some distance. It's reminiscent of sitting in the back of a limousine. The most comfortable seats front and back in this group complements the Honda's excellent packaging. Oh, and it's got the biggest boot too. The CR-V VTIS model that we're testing specifically in this group does come with an auto tailgate, the only one that is standard. And if you want to get a sense of the serious height of the boot, just look at these struts, look at the size of them. Anyway, we've got still a pretty good width to the boot, there's a good depth, we've got a cargo blind, two boot lights, that's one more than any other boot in our group. And what I particularly like are the release levers for the 60-40 split fold seat backs, which eventually go flat. Last but certainly not least, for the Mazda CX-5, Australia's favourite SUV since 2013. We're now onto the second generation model that launched in 2017, with a sharper but similarly sized exterior and a major cabin revamp. On this test, we have the Max Sport all-wheel drive that costs from $36,990. It's not just all-wheel drive thrown in for the $3,000 premium over the Max Sport front drive model. There's also an engine upgrade from a 2-litre petrol to a more powerful 2.5-litre unit. If you take driveaway pricing as at October 2018 into account, the CX-5 and CR-V are the only SUVs that will give you change from $40,000. However, the CX-5's equipment count is the lowest. Like the Forester, the CX-5 Max Sport has smaller wheels compared with the rest of the group, while the Mazda is the only SUV to miss out on keyless entry, tyre pressure monitoring, fatigue warning, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, digital speedo, LED daytime running lights, and a full-size spare wheel. It gets a temporary spare. In its exclusive favour are one-touch electric windows front and rear and an auto-dimming rearview mirror, while only the CX-5 and Forester provide LED headlights and autonomous braking that works in reverse as well as forwards.
So from the back, immediate impression, unless Jez has grown.
Well, you never know. Well, you know, it's first thing in the morning, though. You tend to contract over the course of the day, unfortunately.
Definitely not as much. It's probably half the amount of legroom that was in the Kia.
Yeah, you look a lot closer to the driver's seat.
I am a lot closer.
Well, yeah, CX-5s are renowned for not quite having the best packaging.
Good headroom.
Yep. Agreed.
Yep.
Again, the back seat in this one is quite firm.
So in typical Mazda style, they have an infotainment controller, which I'm convinced sells many, many Mazdas because their competitors don't do it. Mm. However, if I go to touch the screen, there's no touch screen while we're moving. which is unfortunate because maybe the front passenger, might want to dial up an address. However, I can use it from the center console controller, so.
Yeah, but, you know, if you can have a touch screen, you should be able to touch it.
That's a fair call.
But I think the display is disappointing. It just looks too small. Most of the rivals have 8-inch, but, you know, just that 1-inch makes such a difference.
It does look very small, doesn't
and
it?
I don't think the mapping is as sophisticated as in the Kia either.
Just going up that hill, I only had to apply just a little bit of throttle and it was able to maintain momentum quite easily.
Yep.
Quite easy, where in the Sportage it was a bit of a, come on, let's go.
I think it's a little loud. Mazda makes some loud engines these days.
Yes.
Yeah. Sky active, loud active.
The problem is that with the front wheel drive version, you get a 2-litre sky active engine and not the 2.5-litre that we get in this all wheel drive. And it makes a big difference in performance. Did you say this engine was noisy?
I'm sorry. What was that?
At least it's got some go to it, though.
It does ride a little bit firmer. I know some people like that and others don't, but it's worth noting.
Where's my digital speedo?
You don't get one.
You do have a sexy central speedometer, but no digital speedo.
But I want a digital speedo. And the only way you can get it is getting a higher spec version with one of the HUD displays.
So this doesn't have it?
Nope. The Mazda CX-5's ride is middle of the pack here, though it remains one of the most confident handling SUVs around. Its sure-footedness on windy country roads is particularly noticeable. The CX-5's 2018 update also introduced light throttle cylinder deactivation to the 2.5-litre petrol, helping to give it equal best fuel economy with the CR-V and Forester. Packaging continues to be one of the Mazda's shortfalls, though plenty of families will find its practicality sufficient. Technically, the CX-5's boot is one of the smallest in the class and is the smallest in this group test, but it's still a reasonable size and there's some clever touches. We've got these side compartments here that are hidden. And my favourite feature are the 40-20-40 split seat backs with release levers. And you can actually just pull that little centre one there if you just want to have a gap, basically creating a ski port, or you can flick both sides here to have the whole lot going flat, not completely flat, still a little bit of a step here, but not too bad. And then we've got basic tie down points here. So yeah, boot space could be bigger for this class, but it's still pretty good. And welcome to the Car Advice studio, where we're doing something a bit different this time, because if there's something we can guarantee with a comparison test, is that it will always fuel a heated, strong debate in the Car Advice office. And so Rob, Kurt, let's get chatting about this SUV test. And I am going to kick something off with a controversial point, because for last place, in my view, is the newbie, the Forester. Thoughts?
The Forester's just, it's not really doing it for me personally, and it's not just its frumpy looks. You've got the screens and the buttons and all the bells and whistles, but it really lacks just a bit of synergy. And the other thing too is on the road with all the active safety, which is great, unless it's just incessantly just chiming at you and going off with false positives. So that's my take.
It's funny, we expected a debate, but we're not getting much of an argument here. That synergy or lack of it continues inside, I feel, with just too many materials, too many textures. It just doesn't work. There's no cohesion. And that back seat, where I spent a fair bit of my time, that is rock hard. It's like sitting on a church pew doing penance for a sin I didn't know I'd committed.
Well, I don't think it was much softer on the front seat, to be honest. And I know from the driver's perspective, my feeling is that the Forester is not as good to drive as it has been in previous iterations. You know, the ride was too firm. It could be abrupt, fussy. The steering was the vaguest of all the steering systems there. So, yeah, it's kind of gone backwards a little bit and forwards on some other aspects, but kind of, yeah, as a package, it's just kind of not really there.
For the newest car on show here, so strange.
Yeah. You get the feeling that Subaru felt like loading it up with a bunch of kit would lift its overall chops, but I just don't think it has.
Yeah, disappointing. Right, for fourth place, I was dithering between two SUVs. Well, I've plumped for the CX-5 to take fourth. it's a decent SUV, you know, all-wheel drive, a good 2.5-litre petrol engine with a decent bit of torque, handles well for people that are interested in that kind of thing. But, you know, it's lacking features compared to the other models. It's expensive to service. Oh, what do you think, Rob?
I think, despite only being 18 months old in this generation, I think it's a little bit long in the tooth. Like, yes, it's nicely packaged and it feels okay, but it just feels, to me, a little bit old. And that cloth trim in this Max Sport specification, it looks like it came out of a Mazda 2. It looks a bit cheap, cool. If I'm honest.
A bit harsh. So I actually would agree, because I own a Max Sport all-wheel drive in the first generation CX-5, and the seats in there are definitely better than what's in this new model. And we're lacking for interior space, rear seat leg room, smallest boot in the class.
Yeah.
What do you think, Kurt?
And yeah, a lot of people like CX-5. It's a huge selling model in Australia, but I think under the critical eye, it's just a bit middle of the road. It doesn't do anything particularly badly, but it doesn't really excel in other areas other than, I mean, yeah, good powertrain, I'll give it that. But I think as an overall package, it's just kind of lacking a little bit of a special feel, particularly for something for 37 grand.
Yeah, and for me, the Max Sport used to be the sweet spot in the CX-5 range with the first generation. But this time around, I'd say Touring is the pick. It's an extra $1,600 over the Max Sport, but I think it's good value, because for that, you get a head-up display, front sensors, keyless entry, the ability to read speed signs. So, you know, try to make sure you don't go over the limit, as we know it's important in Australia. What do you think?
Yeah, well, it is what it is, I think, so.
Okay, so in the middle of this pack, but certainly not an average SUV for me, the Kia Sportage SLI. A lot to like about this car, I think. You know, beyond its 7-year warranty, it drives well, packaged quite well. What do you think, Kurt?
As an overall prospect, I really like this Kia, but I mean, I think like with Hyundai, they're starting to, with their prices, really lift themselves above the Japanese, so they'd want to be good. And I mean, one thing about this car, 2-litre front drive powertrain, which was, you know, decent and didn't struggle, but was quite make do. And, you know, if you want the all-wheel drive and the gutsy engine, which I believe is a diesel, once you start going up in the range, it's you know, 45 or 46 grand. So, yeah, there's some good and bad there. You know, the good old 7-year warranty from Kia's, you know, pretty good, I think, in terms of, ownership prospects in the long term, but I don't think it's a selling point for this particular car.
And Rob, what you're feeling on the interior, as Kia sort of up in the game in this respect?
I thought it was actually really nice, despite the fact that just about every material, every touch point was black. There's a lot of black. Headlining, everything. There's not a lot of contrast. But surprisingly, it was quite spacious, despite, I think, being the equal shortest wheelbase on this test. It's well packaged. There's certainly enough space for those rear seat passengers, which is important in this segment.
Yeah, it's just, I think it's one of the best looking dashes in this group for me. A driver oriented dash, integrated touchscreen, looks very smart.
Yeah. I like it a lot too, but I think you don't have to wear beer goggles for too long to see that, you know, maybe there's a little bit of Porsche in there before the Kia designers went in and did their thing, so not a bad thing.
Yeah, but, didn't quite take the Porsche plastics quality perhaps across as well, but we are looking at a different price point, I guess.
That's right.
Yeah, but I think as a summary, yeah, it's a good SUV. It drives well. You just feel that 2-litre, for me, it is a bit underpowered, because it's fine when you're on the flat, it's responsive on a light throttle, but as soon as you get onto on a hill, or you want to overtake and you start pushing that throttle pedal, there's kind of just nothing there.
Yeah, it's a bit asthmatic in that regard.
Yeah. Okay, at the pointy end, and the runner-up spot is going to the Honda CR-V. What do we think?
It does have a lot of good points, Jez, not least of which is that interior, which I can only describe as palatial. It's
limousine-like.
It is limousine-like. It's a class. It's like you're stepping up a class. You know? I reckon you could fill it with water and use it as a lap pool. It's that spacious, and it's nicely put together. Plenty of creature comforts. There's really a lot to like about the CR-V.
And it's the only one in this group. You can get a special option for the interior.
You can get a third row if you so need to.
Yeah, so, which is for a VTI L model, which is 38,990. So yeah, it's a few grand extra, but you know, that's kind of the norm.
Yeah, it underlines its you know, superior dimensions.
Yeah, it's pretty special inside.
I don't think the angular Oso Japanese styling, even in Holden Belmont Brown there, is really going to be to everyone's taste. But you do put the Honda under a critical analysis, and I think whether you're the driver or any of the passengers, it's really a difficult car to fault, except in one area. Autonomous emergency braking. And doesn't get it, you can't have it as an option. You need to spend mid-40s for the high-spec version in order to get it as standard equipment. And for me, it's a deal-breaker. This car cannot win because of AEB.
Yeah, the fact that it, you know, a lot of this active safety kit is not even available as an option on the lower models. It's only the flagship. It's it's just a really bizarre decision from Honda, and it's a shame because it undoes so much good work they've done. You know, it's like a superb car to drive in terms of like ride comfort, comfortable seats. You know, the most practical interior there. It, you know, just the storage options alone are quite clever. You know, it's a really good, but yeah, just
so close but silver.
That's right. So we have a winner, the Hyundai Tucson Elite. So that's my view for the winner, but am I talking nonsense?
Yeah, I think subjectively it's probably my favourite car of the field. It's the most impressive and most cohesive of the pack. And, you know, they really put some effort into the interior with the colours and the textures, and it does feel more upmarket than its rivals. And but unfortunately, it is also the most expensive car on show here.
Yeah, well, just on that point on the interior, I mean, this, you know, for this facelift that we've had in mid-2018, it is the biggest step change, I think, for Tucson, because before the dash was, it was just kind of a bit boring, bland, but now it looks pretty special.
Yeah.
It does, and certainly in the colour combination that we ended up getting on test, it looked terrific. I admit I'm a bit of a sucker for a nice tan interior, or as we called it, caramel. It does look like you could lick it. And And back to Kurt's point that it's the most expensive on test, but it also, crucially, I feels like the most expensive. You feel like you're getting your 41 grand's worth or whatever it is.
Yeah.
41 grand?
On road? Well, once you start going on road, yeah, about 42 with on road. Yeah, so it's in terms of on road costs when they're added, you know, it's gapped to the other cars that pushes out a little bit more. But it is the cheapest to service here, even cheaper than the Sportage, surprisingly. 5-year warranty. In fact, the Subaru is the worst here with a 3-year warranty. But the Tucson, it drives well. I think a special note needs to go to the Hyundai engineering team because they've done a great job on the steering and the ride of the Tucson.
Yeah. And it's got good equipment too, and it's got the safety kit. So it's just, you know, for all round completeness and something with a bit of a, you know, semi premium wash, it's that's what got it over the line, I think.
Yeah,
it's a winner.
Okay. There you go then, the Hyundai Tucson Elite is the winner of our mid-sized SUV megatest for 2018. Don't forget to subscribe, and for our full written review, go to caradvice.com. Tucson Elite. Don't forget to subscribe, and no, I'll do that again. Okay. There you go then, the Hyundai Tucson Elite is the winner of our mid-sized megatest bollocks. Don't forget to subscribe. Oh, for God's sake.
Subscribe. Hang on, I need to wipe the tears from my eyes.
Don't forget to subscribe. I can't say it now. I just.
Subscribe, it's not hard work.
Subscribe.
Don't forget to subscribe.
Subscribe?
It's your word.
It's your word.
Sorry. Don't forget to subscribe.